Okay, now let me talk about the system that I ended up getting. And like I said, I've wanted to do this for years. So I always knew since I became aware of Sol-Ark. Sol-Ark is the only company that I am aware of that has an EMP, electromagnetic pulse hardened system that's been tested by an independent laboratory. And if you go up on their website, and I'll have the link to their website below here. They actually have right on their website the independent laboratories report that the Sol-Ark system, they actually zapped it with above the D Department of Defense standard for EMP protection, and the system survived multiple times. So, it is the only EMP hardened solar generator system that I am aware of that's been independently tested. If there are others out there, I apologize. Put it in the comments below. But this is the only one that I know of. I've been talking to Sol-Ark for a long time because I was always interested in getting one of their systems. If we hadn't moved, I would have gotten it up in New Hampshire. But when we came down here and I was finally able to, put my system together, I knew I was going with the Sol-Ark. So I've got a Sol-Ark 12K system, EMP hardened. And it also is, and from what I've heard from several other installers, including like I told you to watch Engineer 775's videos. He talks a lot about, the capabilities of the system. But a lot of installers I spoke to said, number one, it is just a great system with great capabilities, very, very easy to use. I'm not a really, really technically, engineer type of person, and I was able to easily learn how to use this system. Very, very simple. As I said, this system enables me, it's grid tied right now, so if, when I produce more energy than I need, I sell it back to the grid, and that saves you on your electric bill. But if the grid goes down, I can take my house completely off grid, and the Sol-Ark allows me to do either easily. So I can take my whole house off grid, and then I can run all of my panels, right, for the house, right from my system. Now, I can't run everything. So we've got central air and central heat in this house, and those are off the table. I do not have enough power to run central air or central heat. But honestly, my family doesn't need that to survive. We have a wood stove and we have other heating options. And as we saw in even in Texas, that can be an issue. This cold weather that we had this week that caused the great 2021 Texas power grid collapse, people died of exposure in Texas. So cold, no matter where you are, is an issue. Luckily, we have a wood stove. And we have other provisions for heat, for the small amount of time, that we have to worry about it down here, which is basically just a couple months out of the year, probably two, probably January and February. That's it. Yeah, we'll be uncomfortable without the central air, but if we're going without the central air because we're off grid for a long period of time, I think that there are probably bigger problems we have to worry about than that. However, we do have a small window unit, and if it got really, really ridiculous, I would be able to run that window unit with no problem during the day on a, on a real sunny day. So I've got the Sol-Ark EMP hardened 12K inverter. I have 46 320 watt panels, so that's a total of 4.7 kilowatts. Now, here's another thing when you're dealing with solar and dealing with wind for that matter, it's a little bit confusing. So when you're talking about like I have a 2000 watt wind turbine, what does that mean? How much is it going to produce? And I've got 46 320 watt panels. Well, what does that mean? What are they going to produce? So as a practical matter, with the amount of panels I have, and this is, dead of winter, but on a sunny day, I'm pulling down for a couple hours in the middle of the day, the peak sun hours. I'm pulling down 10 to 11 kilowatts off of my solar during those hours. That means I can basically do anything I want. with that amount of power, and that's when I'm selling it all back to the grid. But in times of crisis, if I take my house off grid, during those peak sun hours, we can vacuum the floor, we can do laundry, we can use the stove and cook a lasagna. You know, we've got power out the wazoo for that couple hours a day. So, you know, one of the things you have to think about, so we don't really think about different times of day with the electric grid, because basically you can turn your stove on whenever you want. You can turn your dryer on whenever you want. But in a grid down situation, when you're dealing with your alternative power, you're going to have to think about that. There are going to be times of day where you've got power to spare and you can do anything you want. And then at night, you might have to be more frugal with your power. So, you know, I have a very, very robust number of panels, 46,320 watt panels. That's a lot of panels. And I have a great roof for it too. So my roof is south facing, but it has these kind of facets or dormers on it also. So it's not just a flat south facing roof. I probably have a picture up on the screen right now showing it to you. But what it actually enabled me to do, it wasn't that bad. So I've got the majority of my panels facing south. I have a couple panels facing east, and they light up as soon as the sun comes up in the morning. Those panels start to light up. And then I've got 10 panels that are facing west. And so from about 11 o'clock to noon, those panels light up and they stay lit until the sun goes down. So even though my roof wasn't the perfect configuration for solar, where I would have all of the panels facing south, it worked for us, and it works quite well. I get power from sunup until sundown. Now, the power isn't steady all day long. You know, I'll start off getting, you know, 300 watts, 500 watts, you know, 1,000 watts, and it starts to go up. And then by the peak of the day, I'm pulling down, you know, 10 or 11 thousand watts in the middle of the day. This system, on an average day, I generate between 40 to 50 kilowatts of power off of the solar. Today was a sunny, cold day, which is perfect for solar. I did 74 kilowatts today, and yesterday I did 74 both days. So nice, sunny, cold day. You know, that's a good amount of power. You know, 74 kilowatts is nothing to sneeze at. So now what am I doing with that power? So, you know, during the day, the first thing it'll do is charge the battery. So I've got a 850 amp hour battery bank. I have a lead acid batteries. I couldn't afford the Tesla power walls. Someday maybe I would. In terms of storage, now, first of all, beware. These companies that are trying to sell you a solar system, and they say, no, you don't have to put any money down, we'll put it up for free. First question you should ask them is, am I going to have a battery bank? Because if you do not have a battery bank, you can't use that system if there's a power outage. And they don't explain that very well. But that is a fact. You know, if you want to be able to use, which I would think, to me, if you're buying a solar system or getting a solar system, you would want to be able to use it in a power outage, right? So you have to make sure you have some type of storage. And there's lots of different options. You know, you've got lithium ion batteries, you've got AGM batteries, you have lead acid batteries. I'm using lead acid batteries. It's basically two forklift batteries, 3,000 pounds worth of batteries put together. And they're wired in so that it's a 48 volt battery. My whole system is 48 volts. My wind turbine's 48 volts. My panels are wired for 48 volts. So my whole system is a 48 volt system. The batteries that I have give me enough that I can, you know, all night long pull 2,000 watts steadily off it and still have power to spare in the morning. So basically I have it set up so it'll pull 2,000 watts all night long off of the battery. And then at 7 o'clock, you know, and I can adjust it, you know, the times depending on, you know, when the sunrise and the sunset is. But when the sun comes up, it starts charging the battery. After the sun goes down, I can start just pulling power off of my batteries. And when I'm doing it with the grid, it's just 2,000 watts less of energy I need to pull off of the grid. So energy that I generated, I stored, and I'm using. And if we need more at night, we just take it off the grid. Now, when I take my house off grid, I can adjust the amount of power that I'm going to take out of the batteries, but obviously you don't want to, you can't let your batteries go down. In the case of my batteries, you can't go down below 20%. They're what's called an 80% depth of discharge batteries. So you can't go down below 20% on the particular batteries I have, and different batteries are different. But on these particular batteries, you'll damage them possibly if you go below 20%. So I won't ever let them go below that. And actually, the Sol-Ark is smart enough that it shuts off the batteries if they get down to whatever level you put it at. So in my case, I've got it at 25%. It'll shut them off. But the batteries that I have are robust enough. And so in a grid down, I can pull 2,000 watts all night long, and I can run the well pump and the septic. We're just not going to be baking a lasagna at 1 in the morning, or using the dryer or that type of thing. We'll have to wait until the sun's up in order to do that. But the system, as I said, during a sunny day, it produces a ridiculous amount of power, and then at night the battery gives us enough that we'd be able to use it. Now, I also have a Missouri wind and solar 2,000 watt Raptor turbine, and there's a lot of different turbines out there. Like I said, you got to do your research. There's a lot of debate and a lot of drama, but I've been very happy with this wind turbine. Now, it's a 2,000 watt wind turbine, and that means it's going to give you 2,000 watts if you've got 30 mile an hour sustained winds constant. Other than that, I typically have here between 10 to 20 mile an hour winds. Today it's been about 17 mile an hour winds, and it's generating something. That turbine, it's spinning its little heart out, and it is trickling power into my battery. So the way I looked at it, with the wind turbine, it doesn't produce as much as solar. And in fact, almost everybody tried to talk me out of getting a wind turbine. Almost everybody tried to talk me out of it. But I do not regret it at all. It gives, me some diversification. There have been days where it was really overcast and the solar wasn't producing a whole lot, but that little wind turbine was just chugging along and putting some juice into the batteries. So I'm happy with it. I'm glad I did it. As I said, before you spend your money on a wind turbine, make sure that you've got a suitable location for it. Make sure that your local ordinances, luckily I live out in the county and we don't have any ordinances, so I can put it wherever I want. So I've got mine 35 feet up in the air. I didn't need to get a permit to do that, but depending on where you live, you may have to get a building permit and there may be some limitations. But you want to make sure you can get it high enough up in the air that it's going to be above any obstructions, any trees, anything like that. If your house is on top of a hill, perfect. That's the situation I have. But very, very glad that I did that. It just gives us a little bit of extra power from a diverse source. That wind turbine is spinning right now. It's dark out. My solar's not doing anything, and that wind turbine is just spinning its little heart out, producing some juice. So it's all good. What I'm going to be talking about next is what actually happened when the Texas grid collapsed and how my family was able to benefit from this system. So one last point, I was talking about these people who sell you solar systems and, fail to tell you that without a battery bank, you can't use it if there's a power outage. Well, the other thing, they always try to show you these charts about when the system is going to pay for itself. And, here's my thought on that. The day you get it installed, it is paid for itself if it gives you the peace of mind that if the grid goes down or there's a disaster, you'll be able to take care of your family. Your family will, have water, they'll have the ability to cook, they'll have the ability to do what, you have to do to survive. To me, day one, what I paid for the system paid for itself. I don't really care when the system pays for itself on my electric bill. If it does, it does, and I'm sure it will at some point. I'm not even tracking that because honestly, I don't care. The system already has given me what I wanted, and it proved itself in the Texas grid collapse.